Come on now.
Mm-hmm. What? You want to hear more?
Oh, that's all we need. Another inquisitive soul. Well, listen carefully then. One of the bells is up above in the undead church, but the lift is broken. You'll have to climb the stairs up the ruins and access the undead burg through the waterway. The other bell is back down below the undead burg. Within the plague-infested Blight Town. But I'd die again before I step foot in that cesspool.
Yes, Blight Town sucks, dude. So this is a guy known as the Crestfallen Knight. He's Crest Bro! If anyone ever in the Souls community ever says Crest Bro, this is the guy that's the guy that they're talking about. There are many like him. There's one in DS2. There's kind of one in Bloodborne. There's one in DS3, which is Hawkwood, I think his name is. I can't remember off the top of my head. I haven't played it yet, so you know, I don't know.
Bloody hell! What is it now? You ask too many questions.
See, this is my dialogue's exhausted. Stop talking to me.
What now? I'm not up for chatting. Leave me alone.
So, until you get a dialogue like that, or they repeat themselves, you need to keep talking to them. Because, if you don't exhaust dialogue, they might not trigger the next part in their quest. Which is aggravating. No, I put it on the... That's one thing I don't like about that, is how it just puts stuff into your quick menu there. Okay, so this is the dark sign. Every undead has it. There's a difference between being hollow and undead. For example, I'm going hollow. See? Look at my face. I'm going hollow. I look nasty. He looks human, though, doesn't he? He's got a nice old flesh face instead of a skeleton face like me. We are both undead. And so are the hollows that we'll be fighting in a minute as we go up there. So, there are undead. Undead go hollow, but not all undead are hollow. They're very different things. Hollow means you go crazy, basically. You lose all your humanity, and you lose your mind in the process. You lose your sense of personality, and it's like a zombie, but with more sense. You know, zombies can't fight with swords and stuff. Unless you're in a Romero one, and then they finally learn how to use guns and dead and all that, which is weird. Not bad, just weird. So we can sacrifice humanity at a bonfire. And now I have my human face. Oh, excuse me again. Oh, crap. Well, I have a humanity in my inventory. Oh, I could probably just level up, though. See, you don't want humanity just sitting there unless you feel confident that you're not going to die. We're going to put it in endurance. We're going to put 2 in endurance. Oh, I can do 3. I'll put 3 in endurance. Absolutely. We'll go from 50 to 53 on equip load. So there's that. And this is us. Look at us. Instead of being all zimbified, I look like a scrumptious man, don't I? Alrighty. So, nothing here, okay. There are items in the nooks and crannies of Firelink Shrine. all over the place. I think there's one back here. Back here. Yep. It's firebombs. Firebombs are always fun. Bisque urn filled with black powder explodes, inflicting fire damage. Relatively powerful ranged weapon, especially in situations calling for fire damage. A very precious item at low levels. Many warriors use these to augment their strategic repertoire. And we've got Soul of a Lost Undead. Soul of a Lost Undead, who is long ago gone hollow, used to acquire souls. Souls are the source of all life, and whether undead or even hollow, one continues to seek them. Humanity is a rare, tiny black sprite found on corpses, used to gain one humanity and restore a large amount of HP. This black sprite is called humanity, but little is known about its true nature. If the soul is the source of all life, then what distinguishes the humanity we hold within ourselves? Let me do this as well. The dark sign signifies an accursed undead. Those branded with it are reborn after death, but will one day lose their mind and go hollow. Death triggers the dark sign, which returns the spirit to the last bonfire rested at, but at the cost of all humanity and souls. Then we've got the black separation crystal, which is a multiplayer item. This black crystal, long a symbol of farewell, is granted to banished undead. The crystal sends phantoms to back to their homes or sends you back to yours. Beware of fickle use of this item if you intend to nurture relations. Then we've got the Estus Flask. The Estus Flask. The undead treasure these dull green flasks filled with Estus at bonfire. Fills HP. Estus flasks are linked to the Fire Keepers. The Dark Tales also make reference. An emerald flask from the Keeper's soul. She lives to protect the flame and dies to protect it further. So, somehow, we don't really know what, but most bonfires have a Fire Keeper who tends to the fire and is a draw for humanity, right? She's a draw for humanity, and they are all female. Every single one is female. We don't know why. I have a few theories on it that I think we'll talk about later after we see a little more evidence of it. But we will talk to a couple fire keepers before we get to that. So first, before we go on the rest of our adventure, we're going to talk to
Hello there.
A friend here.
I believe we are not acquainted. I am Petrus of Thoroland. Have you business with us?
Possible.
If not, I'd prefer to keep a distance, if possible.
Probably not.
Hello there.
Hello.
I realize that I have requested that we retain our distance.
I know.
But I also want you to know that it is not meant in ill will.
Well.
Here, take this.
Then you're just talking in circles now, aren't you?
No, go ahead. It's for you.
A copper coin. I'm still going to talk to you.
You again? Oh, I know. How about this? I have to await my companions here anyway. So what if I were to teach you some miracles? Would that please you?
Yes, because we're going faith.
Then first...
Oh, sorry, that was my headphones, guys. I already belong to the covenant.
Let me share my miracles. Only their ultimate effectiveness will be determined by your efforts and your faith.
So we're going to learn the gesture. Then we're going to look at the items to purchase. We've got talismans. So we've got medium for casting miracles of God. Standard talisman issued to common believers. Equipped talisman to cast miracles. Two miracles from a scroll at a bonfire. Most miracles have a limited number of uses. And then we've got a medium for casting miracles of the gods. This talisman is only granted to high-ranking Thoralong clerics. Has high miracle adjustment, which, thanks to divine protection, is not dependent on faith. So it just makes your miracles work way better. We've got Homeward, which... is a great miracle cast by advanced clerics returned to the last bonfire rested at. would normally link to one's homeland, but only the curse of the undead has distorted its power, redirecting casters to a bonfire, or perhaps for undead this serves as home. Actually, we're going to go all the way to the top. Okay. Great miracle cast by advanced clerics restores high HP. The Great Heal excerpt borrows from only several verses of Great Heal. As a result, it can only be cast a stark few times. So it's not complete. The interesting thing about miracles is miracles are stories. They are written accounts of certain things happening in their religious text, I would say. So imagine if you could memorize a page of the Bible and then heal yourself from any injury. You know, that's kind of what we're talking about here. You know, where the gods, I use gods with implied air quotes, because technically they are lords, they are not gods. There is a god in this universe, a goddess, actually. And she is the only one who is actually a goddess. She didn't acquire her power through souls like the lords did. The lords only have power because of their souls. But that's for later. So, force, common miracle amongst cleric knights, creates a shockwave. This quickly acting miracle inflicts no damage but propels foes back in defense against arrows. Cleric knights use this miracle when charging into enemy mobs. Then we've got Seek Guidance, which is a miracle of clerics on an undead mission. Displays more guidance from other worlds. So you cast this and you get more messages on the ground, which is interesting. Guidance facilitates communication between the undead, but their value varies greatly. A balance of faith and wisdom is required. Heal, elementary miracle cast by clerics, restores HP. To cast a miracle, the caster learns a tale of the gods and says a prayer to be blessed by its revelations. Heal is the shortest of such miraculous tales. So it's a story.
My companions are Milady and her young knights. She is young, but burdened by an undead mission. We are her defenses, to keep her from harm. An undead mission? Regrettably, I cannot share that with you. But you are my pupil. Perhaps if you show your faith...
I can't, sorry.
I'm afraid that may be difficult, for our missions are sacred. I'm afraid that may be...
Okay, so that is all
Come
he has
again.
To say, unless
the
you want to pay him.
The effectiveness of the teachings depend upon your faith.
Yep. So I know this is a slow beginning, but I'm building to something. For people who have already seen this, you know, have already played this game, or have already seen other people play it, they're like, get on with it! Get on with it! But, you know, I want to bring in people who have never played and bring them up to speed. Because the whole thing is, you know, I was brought into this series when Bloodborne was released. Because originally I rejected the idea of Dark Souls because I was like, well, it's just hard to be hard. I didn't really look into it. And I was like, well, you know, I don't think I really like it because it's probably cheap and it's, you know, just hard to be hard. And it's like, oh, I play this difficult game and, you know, I don't need that kind of stress. But I didn't know. That's not what this is. It's challenging. And that's the point. It's a challenge. It's not that it's difficult. It's that it's a challenge. And for the most part, these games are completely fair. There are a couple exceptions, and that's why people don't like Dark Souls 2, definitely, and bits of Dark Souls 3, because a little bit of it could be definitely said to be unfair. But this is the best game in the Dark Souls series because it has the best lore, it establishes everything, the DLC is great, and everything's fair. But, you know, let's illustrate something for you guys. This is a graveyard. people who play RPGs normally would go, oh, it's a graveyard. And what are the guys that we're fighting? They're skeletons. Those are usually the beginner enemies. You know, we usually fight skeletons within the first 2 hours of a normal RPG, right? So they should be easy. Well, they're not. They're super, super difficult. See? They're putting a status on me. They're really difficult to kill. And these skeletons actually respawn. If you break them apart, they come back because they're powered by a necromancer. So it is not easy. This is how Dark Souls teaches you. Dark Souls teaches you, you're not strong enough for that. Don't go there yet. Go somewhere else. So we're gonna go somewhere else. And then, once we get a little bit of game behind us, we're gonna go back there. And we're gonna pick up some things that we're gonna need for the rest of the playthrough. Gotta remember where the binoculars are. That's... Hold on, guys. It is early, so that is my alarm. I'm gonna shut that off, and I forgot that I'd even set it. It kind of freaked me out. I jumped a bit. So give me a second. I'm gonna... I apologize for that, my friends. I didn't remember I had set my alarm, but it is early on a Saturday morning. And that is my weekday alarm, but I was up earlier than that. Basically because I was so excited to play this. And wow, does that feel unprofessional? And there's no way to cut it out, so that's going to be interesting. We're going to go rest that bonfire again so that I get my health back. And it's going to show you guys, the new guys, an interesting mechanic that's exclusive to this game. Well, not exclusive to this game, because there are more that do it. There's, oh, what was that Japanese lore-inspired one? I don't remember. But, Lords of the Fallen does it, and, you know, there have been several games since that do this. That guy that I just killed, he's back. When you rest at a bonfire, all the enemies respawn. They come back. Just like you do after death. They're undead, just like you. So they come back. Which is an interesting mechanic. Because then it makes you, you know, think strategically on how... Whoa, I'm playing bad. Come on. Come on now. Backstab! Yeah! Alright, so there's that. So we've got that backstab. We're gonna go grab those items once I deal with these guys up here. Especially that one there with the firebombs. Because he's super annoying. Like, even later in the game, he'll annoy me. Because he'll hit me, and I'm like, I shouldn't be getting hit by this. I've been playing this for 70 hours. These guys are ridiculously easy. I can kill them in one hit without even trying, and, you know, I'm hitting him for 500 damage. It's ridiculous. I shouldn't be getting hit, but I do sometimes. And if it's anybody, it's that guy. The firebomb guy. Alright, so we're going to make it over to the bridge, jump! Yeah! Okay. So, you know, I want to introduce people to this series because I was introduced to this series and I discounted it for a long time because I was like, oh, this is just for masochist guys that, you know, that just want to play something difficult and they want to, you know, It's not legitimate, it's just cheap, so then it's just going to be frustrating. Well, no. This is actually really great. And I was introduced to it because I liked the setting and the look of Bloodborne. So I was like, oh, this looks cool. I'm going to watch an LP of it. So I watched an LP of it. I watched the Super Best Friends do it. I watched their LP of... I watched their LP of Bloodborne, and I liked it so much that I picked up Dark Souls. And I fell in love with Dark Souls. I have Dark Souls 2, and I beat Dark Souls 2 in 3 weeks. Because Dark Souls 2 is ridiculously easier than this game. So poison lasts forever in this game. It's ridiculous. Well, oh no, I'm not going to go rest of the bonfire. Because that would just be doing this section over again. But rats are actually very interesting. Rats are a way to farm humanity. If you need humanity, kill some rats, because they are more likely to have humanity on them. Why? Because rats feed on corpses. So rats feeding on corpses means that they get humanity the same way that I do. Where if you kill a certain number of things, then you'll get a point of humanity. And I'll just go straight into your bar there. Where I have the number 1, it'll tick it over. So if you have 0, it'll go to 1. If you have 1, it'll go to 2, and so on. Man, does poison suck in this game. It's not as bad as toxic, though. Because toxic basically just kills instantly. It's super cheap. Well, not cheap, it's just, you know, super annoying. Yeah, have fun throwing those at me. You're not gonna... Whoop! You're not gonna get anywhere with them. See, this is where this weapon has some issues. Is in close quarters like this, because I do not have a stabbing attack. I have a difficult time hitting things, and I'll bounce off the wall, which kills durability. Yes, durability is a thing. For those of you who've never played this, durability is definitely, definitely a thing. So we will be switching to a new sword presently, but that's going to be a couple bosses hence. Like, we're going to beat... two bosses before we get there? Wait. No, it's only one. So basically, we're going to get to the boss of this area, and then we're going to go to the next area, and there we're going to pick up a new weapon that we're going to run for a considerable while. Okay. So my poison is off, finally. Mm-hmm. Come on, boy. Come on. It's hard to play this game and talk at the same time. Because you have to think very tactically. You know, like I'm using this door to cheat them. Oh, here's a very important thing for you guys to know. Okay, I'm gonna expend some stamina. So then if I block, look how the rate changes. See? It recharges way faster when you have your shield down. So, you gotta drop your shield. You gotta drop your shield. So yeah, that was a whole big shortcut, and watch this. I dropped down, and I did that whole thing. And look, I'm back. This is why Souls games are awesome. Because they have the... You know what? There's all these different paths through stuff. Ah, jeez. Come on, buddy. Miyazaki's Souls games. I say Miyazaki Souls games because not all of them are Miyazaki Souls games, and not all of them have this. Because DS2, Miyazaki didn't actually really work on. So, and Miyazaki is the president of From Software, the publisher, the developer of Dark Souls, or the publisher is named Bandai Namco. So try jumping off. Yeah, that's death. That's just death. But you know, people put down messages like that as a troll sort of thing, and you know, it's kind of a joke. There are more Souls jokes that we'll be encountering, definitely, because if they aren't there when I get there, I'll probably put them down anyway. So we can't make it over there from here. We just can't. So, well, why don't we try? Run and jump! Nope. So, yeah. We have to find another way over there, because there is a couple items over there, and then I will talk about an interesting challenge run that I was thinking of doing. Yeah, dragon. Apparently they aren't all dead. No, that's a drake, which is different. Try death! Yeah, because that's right where the Hellkite Drake's foot landed. And he's going to actually be the source for our new weapon. And everyone knows what I'm going to use now, but, you know, that's that. Come on, buddy. Whoop. Come on. Oh. Oh, what happened? Wood shield. It's a garbage shield. And dead. So before we hit that bonfire, we're actually gonna run back. Come on. See, and this is where you see the programming. Okay, there are two guys over there. Two guys with shields and spears, right? Dealing with them together is a real chore, because one can get behind you and backstab you and kill you, right? So, you find the trigger. This is from much experience with these two. This one triggers before the halfway point. So then you only get the one. Then you wait for him. Come on, buddy. Come on, buddy. Come on, buddy. But you don't want to hit the halfway point on this little bridge here. Because if you hit the halfway point, the other one will come and get you. Come on, buddy. Come on. Yeah, get excited. Come on. Come on, get agitated. Let's go. Let's do this. Step turtle and let's do this. I wish I had that bash attack. You know, you can get that with big shields, but that's not till way later. And since I don't parry a ton... You know, and I know that, oh, parrying's the best. It is the best, but I'm not good at it. Actually, I could probably parry him. Let's check. Let's try. Yeah! I'm doing good at the parrying today. I'm really good at the parrying today. Like, I'm not usually that good at this, and I'm being really good at it today. Let's see. So we've got 100, but this one also has 100? Yeah. And that actually just has less fire defense and less stability. And it's heavier, so it's not good. Let's try metal shield, wielded by hollow soldiers, heavily rusted, but sturdy, providing strong defense. Then we've got a vertically elongated wooden shield decorated with a white dragon. Wood shields are lighter than metal shields, but with lower physical damage reduction and reduced shield stability. See, Now I'm going to tell you how to read these stats. On the right column, damage reduction percentage. Physical damage, that's someone hitting you with a sword, hitting you with whatever, right? It only blocks 93% of that damage, where mine blocks 100, right? It has slightly better magic defense, so if someone shoots a spell at me and I block it, it blocks 40% instead of the 30% that my sword that my shield does. My shield blocks 70% of fire, theirs only blocks 30% because it's made of wood. So, blocking fire, not exactly its best. Lightning makes sense because it's not conductive like my metal shield is, where it only blocks 50%, this one blocks 65%. And stability, it's, you know, it's harder for them with stability. The higher stability you have, it's harder to break your shield, because if you block and they do an attack that saps all your stamina, because when you block it does take stamina, which is the green bar there, if no one picked up on that. You will go into a stagger animation and they can get you, and it's bad. It's bad when that happens. We're gonna take that off.